I'm Peter Brown from Tiny & Sons Glass. Tiny & Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny & Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny & Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny & Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the Eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
February 27th, it is 6:30 p.m. Gary is running late.
The 27th.
27th?
Yep, I'm going to be taping tonight, Madam Chair.
Gail is recording on her own personal device. Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through an audio recording, which will be used to ensure an accurate record of proceedings produced in the minutes of the meeting. All comments made in open session will be recorded. There are a lot of people here. I know Sheila has gone around with the clipboard. If everyone would please make sure they've signed in. We'll wait for Carrie to sign that. Gail, do you think that you are prepared to make a motion in regards to accepting the February 6th minutes of the meeting?
Yes, I would like to make a motion to accept the February 6th, 2017 meeting. February 6th, 2017 meeting.
Okay. Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. The only other thing for correspondence in my file is a letter from the Old Colony Planning Council. It's an agenda that they have sent through. Briefly reading through it, I'm not quite sure if there's anything in there that really pertains to us. But I will note that we have received it, and they do have a future meeting scheduled for March 29th, April 26th, and May 18th. So I'll leave this in the file. We've got about 15 minutes before we have Dennis Lang come forward. Lisa, I want to start through old business and see what you can update us in the next 15 minutes.
Sure.
Septic outbreak at the two Pembroke establishments.
Both are under plans for repairs. I have a call in to Stantec to find out specifically and in more detail what is going on at Pembroke Hospital, but they are having ongoing discussions with DEP as DEP is involved. The other facility is still planning on doing a complete overhaul this spring, and that has not deviated. They are just working their way through the planning board. So call into Stantec, but it hasn't been returned to me. But in fairness, the lead engineer was on vacation this week, so.
Okay. That's acceptable.
Well, I don't expect them to do septic designs on vacation.
I think that is a little mean. Board of Health office activity. How's it been going?
We are getting slammed again. We went from at the beginning of last week with almost nothing on the board. I now have seven perks on the board. Those have all come in the last 4 days. I do not expect much slowdown based on the engineers and the local installers I've talked to. Everyone is already stacking up 2 and 3 weeks out.
Okay. Good luck. Spring market is here.
Are you noticing that on the real estate side?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, then that would explain why we're busy.
That would explain it. The next item is the 13 points of interest pertaining to the Pembroke local regulation upgrades. We have this printed, and sad to say, I'd like to table it again, only due to the fact that I think proceeding in with our discussions this evening, we have some really important items to discuss. So maybe if we can clear up some of these in our old business and our new business, we can look at focusing on this at the next meeting. Sheila,
all right.
On the 13 points.
Are you making a motion?
I am making a motion to table it until our next scheduled meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
That was a second by you, Gail?
Yes, ma'am.
The draft form that we had in regards to recording, did you get to do anything further with that?
It's in your packet?
It is.
It's still a work in process.
Here it is.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm gonna see that.
Yeah. So this is the same one that was attached to the...
Well, it's a little bit different, but yeah.
A little bit different, okay. So you're still working on fine-tuning that.
Yeah, and
it's form. Okay, are we only still down to one, Lisa? Did we have one as of our last meeting
outstanding? We have one open and outstanding, and unfortunately, I'm having trouble getting communication lines open with the homeowner again to keep on top of that situation. I'm hoping that is resolved soon. If not, unfortunately, we will have to summons the homeowner here, even though they're in another state, and I don't know how that's going to work. Either that or the board's going to have to take more significant action.
And this is one
that's been foregoing for, okay. They're supposed to be making repairs this spring, which again, understandably, repairs have to be planned for and budgeted for. However, the concern of mine is when the lines of communication are suddenly cut off, that is a cause for concern.
Realistically, how much time from today's date should we be giving?
I wouldn't give any more than 30 days. Again, I don't know why the lines of communication are cut off, and I always like to give people the benefit of the doubt. However, I've now been trying to reach the homeowner for about a week, and I'm not getting any response.
So you're going to send a certified off?
We're going to have
And give them the 30-day requirement.
We're going to have to. Yeah. Unfortunately, we don't like to put people, if you would, under the gun, mm-hmm. but I don't think at this point we have a lot of choice. 3 phone calls and 2 emails have gone unanswered, and that's a concern.
Right. Okay. What street is this?
That's the Oldham Street project.
Oldham. Thank you.
All right. So I think Gail and I are in agreement. If we could send out a registered letter stating that we do need to have some kind of line of communication open in regards to that violation. If not, we'll have to take
for significant action.
Exactly.
Well, you can draft the health code violations in and put it all in the letter anyways.
We have spoken with this homeowner before. They're not, this is not a case of
no, it's
them
not.
Saying they're not.
Right.
They're very well aware of the situation. They're very well aware it needs to be rectified. I just don't know why the lines of communication have gone dead at this point. I don't have an explanation as I've not heard anything back.
Okay.
All right.
Well, let's see what they'll do with 30
days.
We've
spoken to them at least 3 times. They're not, they, before they were, this was not the case before. This is a new. I don't know. Maybe they're on vacation. I can't explain why suddenly it's not going answered. And it's only in the last week.
So. And we do have the out-of-state address in our systems.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Can I suggest a phone call tomorrow?
Yeah.
Followed up with, if we don't have a response in 24 hours, a letter going out, certified mail?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah, that's
actually,
perfect.
That's actually excellent because that gives them one more shot to respond.
Exactly.
Right.
Not, well,
one day, 24-hour response. Okay. Next one going on, and I'm not quite sure how you will feel, Gail, the town study questionnaire.
Yep.
Lisa had taken a shot at it.
Yep.
We had been given this. Do you want to give any input? We can go through them 1 through 10 with the amount of time that we have left and then go back to it after... Cheryl speaks. This is something the Town Government Study Committee has been looking for from us and all other departments for quite some time. Basically, general question. The first one was, what's your department's, board's, or committee's responsibility? I think that what is written there is pretty
Public Health and Environmental Protection, yep.
Yep, I think that pretty much covers it.
Yep.
So I don't have a problem.
I don't have a problem with that. With number one?
So one's okay. To who do you report? Attach the organizational chart, which we have a organizational chart.
I have an organizational chart, but it's not on the agenda tonight, therefore I cannot submit that.
You have a separate one other than this one? God, I can't read it. Board of Health is over here. Health Agent is under the Board of Health. This is, just want to double check because they would be putting, attaching to this Government Study Committee, the most recent one that we have, the most recent one that I have in my possession, puts the Board of Health, the Health Agent under the Board of Health, which then falls under the main category of town meeting and voters, which would be, we report to the town of Pembroke.
Oh, Mr. Fine is here. See if I can.
Yeah, there shouldn't be any different. But what it's saying is that we will attach. We do not report to anyone, which is what the statement reads to answer the question. The Board of Health is an independently elected three-member board with three-year terms.
Mm-hmm.
So the question was, does the attached organizational chart properly reflect? If no, additional information. We do not report to anyone.
Right.
He was here, but Gary went
somewhere.
Okay. That's the answer.
Okay.
Unless you would like to...
I would like a copy of the organizational chart, because I didn't seem to... Did I get that, Sheila?
Yeah.
You can have mine.
Okay.
Unfortunately, it doesn't have a date on there, but I believe after reading it earlier today, it should be in order.
Okay. Where does the secretary fall under this?
I believe.
Okay, we've got.
Right here.
Yeah, Board of Health, Gary, and then Cullity, Lisa Cullity. And then it should be the secretary. Right?
Well, we don't have an org sheet. Lisa and or Sheila, do you know where you fall on this org sheet that was presented to us?
I do not.
Whereas Sheila is not being called out because you don't report. You are part of the Board of Health, but who do you report directly to?
On a day-to-day basis, I report to the town administrator.
Correct. Yeah.
For day-to-day, mm-hmm. But I take my direction from you.
Correct.
So a little bit of both.
Yes, so with that question, I think what we need to do, further adding to question number two. Hi, Gary.
Okay.
Hello.
To Sheila's position.
Further adding to the continuation.
Sorry.
That we do not report to anyone. The Board of Health is an independently elected three-member board with a three-year term. I think we would add the position of secretary held by Sheila Landy reports to the three-member Board of Health, and on a daily basis reports to the town administrator. I think if we call out those two separations, that should be sufficient enough. Does anybody disagree? Would you like to put that question to further? Challenges? Information?
Nope. just to put Sheila on there.
Okay, on that org chart?
Yeah, we just really need to add our staff.
Yeah, okay. So number two's good with adding that. Number three, we're going to, under the Massachusetts General Law, does your department committee fall under? There are too many. The answer to this is, what do we fall under? Massachusetts General Law. There are too many to list. The top general laws we fall under are the 310 CMR 15, 105 CRM 172, 105 CMR 410, 105 CMR 590, 105 CMR 430, 435, 440, 445, 450, 451, 460, 480, 660, and 675. There's an awful lot of laws in Massachusetts general law that a Board of Health would fall under.
Speak.
Yes.
Can I just add something?
Sure.
If you say Chapter 111, that's the statute that controls public health in general. Mass General Law, Chapter 111.
Town Committee. I can find it.
Town Committee.
Okay.
Please note that Sheila from the...
Cheryl.
Cheryl.
Massachusetts Association of Health Boards.
Thank you. Has stated
Cheryl
that if
Sabar. Sabar? I've heard your name a million times. Always good. Always good. Okay.
So we could basically change that to read Chapter 111 instead of calling out all these separate ones, and that will be a umbrella over all of it.
The Code of Mass Regulations all come within Chapter 111. They're regulations enabled by Chapter 111.
Okay. Okay. Well, I don't have any disagreement with that. Mm-hmm. Agreed?
Agreed.
Gail?
Yep.
Yes?
Yes.
Barry?
Yes.
Okay. Good. We're all set there. We'll change that to Chapter 111. Currently, right now, I'm going to stop what I'm doing. We're going to pick up at number four. We are going to ask Dennis Lane from the Massachusetts Coalition for Responsible Retailing to please come forward.
Where would you like me?
Can I ask you to? Yeah. There you go.
You want me to sit right here?
Sure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Could I just ask Mr. Lane a quick question?
Of course.
Mr. Lane, before you speak, could you just maybe educate the board or just the folks that are in the room? Just give a very quick synopsis on, so you work with the Coalition for Responsible Retailing. So their mission is, they do?
The focus is mainly retailers who handle tobacco and age-restricted products, and as the name implies, the goal is to get the message out and to work with cities, towns, planning boards, whatever, that we do not tolerate, we do not accept, and we do not educate people to sell to minors. Our goal is exactly the opposite. We believe that if the current laws are enforced and reasonable laws are put in place, and if necessary, enhanced, that the control of sales of any age-restricted product, alcohol, tobacco, lottery, to minors can be effectively dealt with. So we're just trying to, retailers need to make a living. Responsible adults should have their right to purchase legal tobacco products protected, and that's what we're all about.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, what would you like? We've actually had a array of people come through in regards to the raising the 21, tobacco age to 21. You did want to come in front of us. We've had pro, con, and now we'd like to hear from the retailing side of it. Your opinion.
We tend to believe that a municipality needs to do what they believe is best for controlling minors for buying cigarettes. There's two sides to the story. A lot of people believe that if someone is going to go to Afghanistan or go overseas and fight for their country, they ought to be able to go to the local convenience store and pick up a pack of cigarettes. The other side of that coin is the swing in a lot of towns and cities seems to be to 21. I don't know. I'm also a retailer and I own a convenience store in Massachusetts and have for 43 years. So I don't know how much of a difference. The problem with raising the age to 21, in my opinion, is that if all the surrounding cities and towns don't raise the age to 21, the young people who want to buy tobacco who are 18 will simply cross the border, and they'll just go to an adjacent town and they'll buy tobacco. I personally don't believe that it's going to significantly change the landscape as far as young people buying cigarettes, but I also don't challenge cities and towns' reasonable right to do that. So the main reason why I'm here is to talk about the fact that there are a tremendous amount of things. First of all, the age verification stings and the visits to stores are having a huge impact. And when people come before you and give you information on underage smoking, I'd caution you to make sure you look at the footnotes and see how old the information is, because the most current information from the Center for Disease Control is that over the past 5 years, underage smoking is actually down 7.5%. The other thing is, there's a lot of talk, not just in Pembroke and all around the state and of course all around the country, that tobacco companies and retailers are targeting youth. It would be suicide, my business is in Quincy, it would be suicide for me to sell to minors. Responsible adults who want to buy, people who don't smoke, wouldn't buy bread, milk, and lottery and newspapers in my store if I had a reputation for selling to their kids. That's not something that we want to do. So I think one of the biggest challenges we have is educating communities that there are no purchase, possession, and use laws. A minor in Massachusetts, throughout the state, can get a package of cigarettes somehow, some way. He can stand in front of the police department and smoke it. Nobody can take that pack of cigarettes away from him. There are no purchase, and there are no restrictions on him. A minor can even come to my counter, or any counter in the state, and ask for cigarettes. It's not illegal for a minor to go to the counter at a convenience store and say, may I have a pack of Marlboros? It's illegal for us to sell it to him, and it should be, but it's not illegal for him to ask, it's not illegal for him to possess it, and what's more absurd is, it's not illegal for him to use it. So I think there are purchase, possession, and use laws that would be much more effective ways of controlling underage smoking.
That's extremely conflicting, yes.
The other thing is, we talk an awful lot about, you know, flavors. You know, kids are attracted by flavors. I think if you look at the alcohol industry, which is obviously age restricted, you can, for 99 cents, you can go to any liquor store and buy a honey flavored nip. You can buy a strawberry nip. You can buy a cognac flavored nip. You can buy grape nips. You can buy. So I sell honey flavored cigars to a lot of blue collar workers on their way home from work who want to go home and have a beer and light a cigar. And they're 30, 40, 50 years old. So I don't think that we have to lump all the responsible adults who want to buy legal and enjoy legal tobacco products by raising the price on single cigars or packs of cigars to $5, on making flavored cigars, because it's just, in my experience, you're punishing responsible adults who want to go and enjoy a cigar. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, if I've worked all day and I go home and my wife hands me a beer and I want to light a cigar, I shouldn't have to go somewhere else to buy that cigar. And it just seems sometimes, and I'm not, you folks have a really hard job, and I see that your city hall is open tonight and it's active, and that's a wonderful thing. This is all about what local government is about. But every once in a while, I think the big brother syndrome, and I don't mean that in a mean way, the big brother syndrome overtakes responsibility. And I'll use an example. The town of Concord banned bottled water. We oppose that. They banned bottled water under 1 liter. And they're a town that has a very aggressive recycling program. They don't have a trash in the streets program. They're a very affluent, up-and-coming town. They banned 1 liter water under 1 liter. They banned spring water under bottled water under 1 liter. So what did people do? They go to all these, when they want to buy waters, take them to the softball team, take them to the football field, they go to the next town over. But the other thing is, they didn't ban 1 liter Coca-Cola. They didn't ban 20-ounce Coca-Cola. They didn't. So you can go and buy a plastic bottle filled with Coke or Pepsi or Sprite, but you can't buy a bottle of water. Probably one of the most healthy and benign products that you can buy. So it just seems like sometimes the goals of cities and towns contradicts the reality. And I think and the other thing is too, and I say this because I'm a retailer, I was 23 years old when I bought my store. We have minimum wage at $11 in Massachusetts. We're facing a national minimum wage of $15, not that far away. We're facing Obamacare. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have health insurance. We need to be able to afford health insurance. 40% of my sales are tobacco products. So every time I hire from the neighborhood, a lot of kids got their first job in my store. And so our ability to stay financially healthy, our ability to hire, to pay taxes, to grow, to support the community, to support the Little League that I support, to support the cops and kids basketball programs that I support, those are all based on my income, on my revenue. So I think, I'm not saying that we should support tobacco products at the expense of youths, on young people. I think that we should probably look very strongly at enforcing possession, use, and those.
Well, it's got to be accountability. If you're an accountable as a business owner, there should be an accountability for the person that's purchasing and know that they're purchasing.
Well, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
There really should be an accountability.
Yeah. And we spend an awful lot of time and effort training our employees on, not just with cigarettes, but also with lottery. And we just recently in my store got a beer and wine license, and I'm scared to death that, you know, I mean, that's going to be one more thing. I want the business. I need the increased business because of minimum wage and other expenses, but I'm going to have to do the right thing and make sure that my employees are trained to handle any aid. We ID for lottery in my store.
Right.
I don't want my neighbors who send their kids up to my store for Snickers to think there's a possibility that Johnny's going to get a pack of Marlboros. I don't want that reputation. I've been to weddings, funerals. The kids who were catching the school bus in front of my store in the 70s are coming in with their kids now. And everybody makes a mistake. Everybody once in a while has an employee that doesn't pay attention and something slips through, but we're fined pretty seriously. It hurts our reputation. So I would just ask that this Board of Health use reason and care and protect the right of responsible adults to buy products, including flavored tobacco, and look at, continue to enforce these things and the education and the communication with the retailer community. No retailer in this state, almost no retailer in this state, wants to sell to a minor. And so I guess, unless you folks have questions for me, I'd like to take questions if you want.
I think the 21, when they raised it, what was that, back in the late 70s, when they raised the drinking age from 18 to 21?
Yep, that would be
to
right.
18 to 20.
20.
Yeah, to 20, and then 20. They went up to 20. All right, I'm a little early. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think that was a wonderful move, and I think it was a promising move because I, out of experience, I don't know what my coworkers, but I have a large family, which brings friends, and the age of 18, they're just getting used to driving a car, and they're getting that power behind their belt.
I don't disagree with it. They're driving a 10,000-pound truck down the road, and they're not paying attention.
And now we got cell phones, and we got all kinds of distractions.
And more people are hitting trees now because of cell phones than because of alcohol.
Yeah.
But tobacco is not really a distraction. It's and I agree with you.
I understand that, but it tobacco kind of falls into the category where you really should be old enough for a substance if you're going to put a substance into your body. And I know that tobacco's not. I am a smoker, so I know that tobacco's not a mind altering thing. But it's hard not to group those together as far as...
As a health issue.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't disagree.
In general.
I don't disagree. And we don't support or not support that. We believe that's a decision that needs to be made by every city and town.
Yeah, it needs to be addressed.
Right. But once again, you know, it's... I remember I wrote an article for the Boston Globe because shortly after the town of Concord banned bottled water, the University of Vermont banned bottled water. But then they took an $800,000 contract and put Coke machines all over the campus that sell 20-ounce bottles.
I still can't wrap my brain around that.
How contrary is that? So a kid that's in college wants to go and put a buck in the vending machine and grab a Coke. It's his decision. We really, I've been to some meetings and I've heard some retailers and I've heard some residents, and I'm especially thankful when a resident stands up and says, we need to move away from the big brother mentality.
Yeah.
If a responsible adult wants to go home and smoke a cinnamon flavored cigar, a peach flavored cigar, and go to the liquor store and buy peach flavored schnapps or peach flavored wine or whatever, they should be able to.
Right.
But I don't think that those things impact in any way underage smoking. And I think ever since the huge settlement several years ago with the government, I really don't believe, ever since the Joe Camel days, and those were horrible, no one denies that they were tackling, Joe Camel was targeting teens, and no one will deny that. But I think everyone's learned their lesson, and I think you get more purchase in your community being a responsible retailer and not selling to kids than you do just restricting pack sizes and prices and flavors, because in the effort to control underage smoking and underage use, you're throwing all the adults into the bathtub with them, and you're throwing them out with the bathwater, and that's just not right. And it's also the guy who really wants to smoke a peach cigar, he's on his way home from work, he's going to stop at a store in a community where it's not restricted. So
I think what this is really coming down to, number one, is the fact of raising the legal age to purchase any type of a tobacco product to the age of 21. But there also becomes a very large voice that talks about the flavors. So one of the things that this board wanted to look at was kind of like a laundry list of how you pick and choose, which is something we had done about
2 years ago.
2 years ago in regards to vaping and electronic cigarettes that were sold right at the Cumberland Farms, any convenience store that were allowed, but there was no age restriction on them, which is a problem that we had. The state hadn't come down with anything, so we decided as a town to put it to 18. Now we're looking at 21. So we're going to kind of go through almost like a cherry picking of what types of rules and regulations we would like to see in place, one being age, and also several probably being flavors. As a retailer and a owner of a retail store, would you be adverse to raising 21 but leaving the flavored different types of tobaccos, the cigars, the backwoods?
Well, sure, because my opinion is that the 21 solves an incredible amount of problems.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, obviously, we're in business to sell stuff. We would prefer 18, but if the town decides that 21 is what it wants, then so be it. But the age of 21 solves all those problems. Young people can't get flavors. They can't get cigarettes. They can't get snuff. It doesn't matter if anyone over 21, not that it's healthy, not that they should, but anyone who's decided, and they're an adult of their own volition, they're going to buy cherry-flavored snuff, and they're 21, they should be able to buy it.
Right.
And I think I agree with you 100%. I think that if you enforce the age restriction, it's, and the other thing, and I know I keep saying it, is I just think it's insane that these kids can't purchase, but they can use it, they can have it, they can stand in front of the police station and smoke a cigarette.
There's got to be accountability on both sides. You certainly get fined and for anything that you do out of character. If you sell a pack of cigarettes to a minor, you're subjected to fines.
My manager was behind the counter last year, she's been with me 8 years, training a brand new girl, 16 years old, it was her first job. She had been through the age-restricted training. My manager turned to answer a question for somebody, and the kid sold a pack of cigarettes to a stink. And it was not that, and 1,500 people a day come through my store. I'm not proud of that, and we were fined, and we educated the girl. But, I mean, it just takes...
But there was no responsibility on the party that actually went in and bought
that
it.
Absolutely.
Well, it was and that's the
it
same
was
as...
It was a sting, that particular
It was
instance.
A sting.
Okay.
A sting. But still, it should be illegal for a 15-year-old to come to my counter and say, I mean, you take a 15-year-old girl, you put her in heels, you give her a pocketbook, put a hat on her and a pair of sunglasses.
Don't have to tell me, there are a lot of children.
30.
Yep.
She looks like she's 30. And so the goal here is, the reason the Coalition for Responsible Retailing was formed is that I think there's an urban myth in a lot of town halls across the state and city halls that, you know, us evil convenience store owners want to sell to kids. And nothing could be further from the truth. You know? I don't want to look at a mom who's coming in and buying milk in my store and have her looking at me wondering if the pack of cigarettes she found in her daughter's pocketbook came from me.
Right.
So I really believe that the enforcing a minimum age and looking at developing some use and purchase restrictions is, you know, if the cop took the pack of cigarettes away from a kid and gave him a ticket or said, call your mom, I'm taking you to the station to the juvenile officer. Your mom, if a mom had to go and pick up a kid because they had a pack of cigarettes.
You are so right.
So, and we're all for all that type of stuff.
Yes.
The main reason I just, you know, I just don't want to punish the people who want to go and buy a cigar, buy a cigarette, buy
no,
a
pack. No, you don't. No, you don't. But we want to make sure that they're at an accountable age where they're understanding.
Yeah.
Back in the 60s, there wasn't a lot of understanding, and things have changed rapidly as far as restrictions with smoking, you know, with drinking, that we've seen throughout the years.
Yeah.
They have changed. But they've changed individually.
Yeah.
And it really is a group. I mean, when you're talking about anything that's going to alter you, or you're going to put considered carcinogenic.
And if I can share with you a funny anecdote that one of my customers said to me, he said, you know what? He said, a lot of states and a lot of cities and towns are trying to ban menthol cigarettes. He said, but Massachusetts is approving marijuana. He says, so pretty soon I'll be able to buy a joint, but I won't be able to buy a pack of menthol cigarettes. And so, once again.
I know, the irony of it. Gary, I'm going to let you wrap this up with Dennis if you have any questions.
And I appreciate your time.
You are quite welcome.
Just a couple of comments. First of all, you I love the name of your organization, Responsible Retailing. So as I sit here as a Board of Health member, the people in the audience in the back, they're looking at your back, but I can see the passion and the commitment that you have. So I don't know you personally. I'm from the city of Quincy, so a little shout out to you there. Okay. But kudos to your passion. You know, I applaud you for coming in and speaking on behalf of the retailers. You know, you made reference a couple of things, Dennis. You talked about overreach and big government. And I don't want to speak for my fellow board members, but I think that we as a small Board of Health in the town of Pembroke, we pride ourselves on being conscious of that big brother and overreach. And I only want to point you to 2 years ago when Chair Bagni made reference to 2 years ago there was no age restriction for vaping in Pembroke.
Yeah.
We instituted a law. We went from, I guess, age of zero to 18. But we were also very cognizant of the retailers. We didn't ban the cinnamon-flavored individual e-cig or cigar. We simply went the age from 0 to 18. So I think when we put that law in place, we were thinking about the health of the younger folks, but we were also thinking about the retailers. So I don't know, ultimately, when we vote on going to T21, Chair Bagni mentioned we'll be looking at a cherry-picked list of different things. I'm going to speak for myself, and I'm not out to punish the local retailer. You made a lot of reference to menthol and the other flavors. I'm well past the age of 50, and I'm the king of sweet tooth, so I hear you. The other thing that I just want to comment on, and my board members have probably heard me say this ad nauseum, I have two sons, and I'm very proud to say that both of my sons are officers in the U.S. Navy, and I've had many conversations about them because we often hear the argument. We're old enough to fly a jet and fly to Iraq and potentially lose our lives. I can't buy cigarettes. And when I talk to both my sons when they come home from the Navy, they are so pro and they are so health conscious about raising the age to 8 to 21. They laugh when they hear. They think that is such a silly argument. You know, there are so many arbitrary ages out there. You know, I don't know why one has to be 16 and a half to drive a car, 21 to purchase alcohol. So that particular argument is near and dear to me, so that argument doesn't work for me. But thanks for coming in, and you said a lot of good things.
And just on the electronic cigarettes,
go ahead.
When those were launched, the industry should have launched them with age restriction. They should have launched them because when they first came out, people were smoking them on planes. And finally, American Airlines put a $10,000 fine. They were the first to say, if you pull out an electronic cigarette, we're going to fine you. And it's like candy cigarettes that puff fake smoke. We don't want to give the illusion that smoking anything is okay. So I applaud you. Whereabouts in Quincy did you grow?
Marymount.
Okay. My store's on Adams Street.
Nice.
But anyway, thank you for giving me the time.
Dennis, thank you very much.
With your permission,
for coming
I'd like
in.
To stay in here.
It was a pleasure to meet you.
And I just wanted to ask, are there any residents of Pembroke here that wanted to speak on this at all?
I am not a resident, but we operate in the town of Pembroke.
Okay. As a retailer?
Yes.
Okay. You want to, I'll give you 2 minutes to add?
Sure.
If you'd like to?
Yes, or she was scheduled next, if you'd like to let her speak and then I could go after.
Could I ask you to speak a little louder, please?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I was saying she is scheduled to speak next. I could speak after her if that would be better.
All right, and your name for the record?
Anna Betancourt.
Anna Betancourt, okay. Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, Cheryl.
We're just great, Cheryl. Come on in.
Sure. I thought we were just discussing 21, but I'm happy to discuss other strategies as well.
Yeah.
But first, since I was asked to come and speak about 21, I will. And Member McSweeney also said what the Institute of Medicine report basically said in 2015, that it's really a brain development issue, and that if you increase the age to 21, they looked at 18, 21, and 25. Mm-hmm. And while the brain doesn't really fully develop until 25, they felt that the report concluded that increasing it to 21 would be an extremely important public health strategy and would save lives. And what's interesting is I really appreciate the previous speaker's comments and his articulate way of presenting his views, but I will tell you that before this report came out, the Coalition for Responsible Retailers said let's wait until the IOM report comes out, the Institute of Medicine, and then let's see what we'll do. And then when the Institute came out with 21 as being the age that they would recommend, then the Coalition for Responsible Retailers changed their argument. Mm-hmm. And when we look at the military argument, I will just underscore, when the state of Hawaii went to 21 for tobacco sales, the federal bases, the military bases in Hawaii did not have to comply with that state law.
No, they don't. None of the,
because it's
none
a
of the
federal,
other, yeah.
It's under federal jurisdiction. However, every single base in Hawaii supported increasing the age to 21. A spokesman for the Navy said, "We see it as a fitness and readiness issue." Rear Admiral John Fuller said, "If someone is young enough to fight for their country, they should be free from addiction to a deadly drug." So
exactly.
The military has supported this. The leadership in the military has supported this. So that argument has sort of gone away. Right now in Massachusetts, we have 145 municipalities that have enacted the minimum legal sales age of 21. That represents almost 63% of the state's population. The municipalities surrounding you, which my colleague was nice enough to point out to me, Bridgewater, Carver, Duxbury, Halifax, Hanover, Kingston, and Whitman all have minimum legal sales age of 21. And I would also say that, you know, while compliance checks, illegal sales rates to tobacco, frequently what the Coalition for Responsible Retailers cites, and I'm not saying that the previous speaker was citing this, but what they frequently say in the letters that they submit in testimony is that if you look at the FDA checks, and those are checks done by the Food and Drug Administration, the sales rates are very, very low. And that's very, very true. But the reason they're so low is that the protocol for the FDA was to go in and have a 16-year-old ask for Marlboros or Newports. Those aren't the brand, those aren't the products that youth are buying. They're buying the cheap, sweet, easy to get products. They're not buying a pack that costs $10.
$10.
If you are looking at the pup laws that Mr. Lane mentioned, I would strongly suggest that be done as a bylaw and that the police be put down as the enforcement agents. Board of Health agents and tobacco control programs do not have the skills necessary to confiscate products from youth, to ask for ID from youth. That's not what we do. Many municipalities have considered this approach. It's an approach that's promoted by the tobacco industry. I'm not saying the retailers, I'm saying the industry. They really like this approach. The problem with it is that it's virtually unenforceable, certainly unenforceable by a Board of Health. So if the police would like to take this on, there is not one instance that I know of when the police are charged with enforcing Chapter 260, Section 7, which is the state law that prohibits selling tobacco to a minor. I do not know of one instance where the police have actually enforced that state law. Mm-hmm. That's why we've done this locally, right, so we could have Board of Health.
So that's a place where we could probably
try. But let me also tell you that the municipalities that have that law on the books, none of them in Massachusetts are enforcing that now.
Mm-hmm.
None of
them.
So just if you want to spend your time doing that, or the town meeting wants to spend its time doing that, just be very careful with the enforcement. A lot of the larger cities won't do it because they feel it's a method of targeting certain kids. You see them smoking, you target them, you do an illegal search of them, and you find the drugs that you were looking mm-hmm. for. And it tends to target, when it's been done in other parts of the state of the country, they tend to target people of color. So those are just some things to consider. I would certainly not do it as a Board of Health regulation.
Okay.
Have the police involved in that if that's a road you want to go down.
Do you know of the surrounding towns in Pembroke?
Do any of them have possession on? I don't believe so. I can pull that out for you.
Okay.
And you can check with them, but I can go back and look at that. And I would also say, and I'm not, I have no business speaking about Mr. Lane's business. It's his business. He knows what his profit margin is. He knows mm-hmm. what his business plan is. But I will say, and my husband's a smoker as well, tobacco is the only consumer product that, when used as directed, kills. If we were here talking about lead paint, this board would be the first board to prohibit lead paint mm-hmm. being sold. Okay? So this project, well, yes, it's an age-restricted product, but it's not an age, it's a unique age-restricted product. The Surgeon General has determined it to be an unreasonably dangerous and defective product.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a consumer product, it's an age-restricted product, but it is a defective consumer product, but yet we're still selling it. You know, we're still selling it. We're selling it less and less, and I'm sure Mr. Lane would agree that when he first started his store, he was selling much more tobacco than he is now. And the problem isn't Mr. Lane, the problem is that the industry spends $24 million a day marketing in these convenience stores. Now, there's a reason they do that. They're not dumb. They're very smart, and they're very wealthy. They know that two-thirds of teens visit a convenience store or another neighborhood retailer at least once a week. They also know what the Surgeon General concluded back in 2012, that exposure to tobacco marketing in stores and price discounting increase youth smoking. You can look at I actually brought a summary, the executive summary of that report from the Surgeon General. It goes through all of the epidemiological studies mm-hmm. of this. There's a correlation, and the industry knows that. So the reason we suggest taking these products, and we're not banning, we're not suggesting that they be banned. An adult that wants to smoke a cotton candy cigar should be able to smoke a cotton candy cigar. It is a legal product. It's a defective legal product, but it's a legal product. We would like to restrict the sale of those products, those cheap, sweet, easy-to-get products, to adult-only retail stores.
Mm-hmm.
This doesn't prohibit an adult from getting or smoking that product.
Like a Brennan smoke shop?
A Brennan smoke shop. They're not... Right, they're not subject
to
our regulations.
It's not at Cumberland Farms,
it's
which is our...
It's not a store that kids go into.
To get a soda or to get something, yes.
We frequently, and it's very understandable, we think, okay, if we just didn't sell to minors, if our retailers are responsible and they don't sell to minors, that this issue is just going to go away. It's not. As long as these products are in view of and are aggressively marketed to kids, kids are going to want them. And I will just end with a couple of statements from the industry, and again, not from retailers. This one was from a Reynolds rep. We don't smoke that S blank blank tea. We just sell it. We reserve the right to smoke for the young, the poor, the black, and the stupid.
Wow.
So it's not about, it's not just about having them in convenience stores. It's about marketing them, aggressively marketing them to kids. And you will, you can see it yourself. There was a convenience store conference a while ago, and there was a webinar put up by Tom Bryant, who is the National Association of Tobacco Outlets. He's the general counsel. And he first started his webinar, and it was all on these local strategies and how you should fight them. And he first thanked all of his smart partners. One was Altria, which is Philip Morris. One was Reynolds, and one was Cheyenne. I mean, This is their strategy, and it works, and that's why they're doing it. And does it affect convenience stores? Yes. I'm not going to stand here and say it doesn't. But the right to protect public health, business interests don't come first. The first right, the paramount right, is to protect public health. And that's been upheld by the Supreme Judicial Court time and time again. And then lastly, there was a federal court judge, a case, the United States versus Philip Morris, Reynolds, etc., from not too long ago, where the judge said that cigarette manufacturers spend billions of dollars every year on their marketing activities in order to encourage young people to try and then continue purchasing their cigarette products in order to provide the replacement smokers they need to survive, that the business needs. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's a complicated issue, but we're dealing with a defective product. And if adults want to smoke it, they can smoke it. I wish my husband didn't smoke, but he does. He quit for about 20 years and then picked it up again.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand it. but to put our kids in harm's way every time they go in to a neighborhood store,
right,
they're getting the marketing that the industry is targeting toward them. And that's the sticky wicket that we're up against.
I think the state's heading in the right direction. I think that they were heading in the right direction when they started banning cigarettes, whereas smoking restaurants, drinking establishments, and mm-hmm. things like that. I think this will actually catch up with it. It's just a shame that when we're putting out regulations that we don't think of the downfall effect that's going to come along with everything else.
Well, unfortunately, I think that needs to start with our lawmakers, and they can't, they're trying to get out of a wet paper bag at this point.
Yeah.
But with that being said, unless anybody has any questions on the board.
I can leave this.
Thank you. One of the things, Cheryl, that we have done as a board is we have previously voted to raise the age in the town of Pembroke to 21. What we are left with now is to be able to create a boilerplate. One of the things that we have here is from July 2014. Would you like some water?
No, I have one.
Okay.
There's actually a more recent one.
Okay, because we're looking.
2016.
Okay, we would like to take a look at that in regards to the sample. This is headed sample regulation restricting the sale of tobacco products.
Do you need this back?
If you could make a copy of that,
sure.
Just so I have one.
Yeah.
Oh, actually, no, I think I have one.
Okay, if you could make us all a copy.
I do have one.
What I'd like to do is talk with the board further in regards to a motion on whether we're going to go forward this evening with looking at that list and assigning. For those who do not know what I'm talking about, There's a policy decision checklist, which has a variety of a multitude of questions that can be answered yes or no, which would fine-tune Pembroke's law. We as a group will look at them and vote, whether tonight or at our next scheduled meeting, but that's something that I would like to take a look at.
Chair Bagni, if I could remind you, 2 weeks ago, we actually met 3 weeks ago, I was the one who 2 years ago made the motion to introduce the vaping.
Yes, you did.
E-cig to 18. I was also the one who made the motion to move from 18 to 21, the T21. In that motion that I made 3 weeks ago,
thank you,
I had said in that motion that we would vote on the specifics 2 weeks after meeting with Cheryl, who was already scheduled to come in.
Okay.
So I myself would not like, I would like to stick by that original motion and vote on the specifics at our next meeting.
Okay, and with that being said, we have now a regulation restriction, which actually has a checklist of 22. So if we can add this to our next scheduled meeting, Sheila?
Yeah.
In regards to going over the sample regulation, restriction of the sale of tobacco products. Did you get a copy of this?
I do.
Okay, perfect.
I have a question for Ms. Segarra.
Well, can I first get a second ahead on that?
Sure. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So we will move that.
Is that unanimous?
Yes,
ma'am.
Are you available between now and the next 2 weeks if
I believe.
If there are any questions on any of these particular 22 bullet items,
sure.
Would you prefer that we go direct our questions through Health Agent Cullity?
Whatever works for you. I'm out of state from March, the week of March 20th, but other than that, I'm good.
Okay. On when you leave, could you perhaps leave a contact number with Sheila?
What I will do is leave you my card.
Great, thank you.
Okay, you're out the week of the 20th. Are you home on the 27th?
Am I around on the 27th? On what day was it?
March 27th?
Yes, I come back Sunday night.
Okay.
Okay, perfect.
Now, I will not be out beyond vacation. I'm not going to be attending this. Is there a way that I could leave my boat, or how do we do that?
Well, I think that you can phone in.
Okay.
Lisa, can she, is it possible for Gail to put her, circle her yes or no's?
Of course.
To submit it to the meeting before I go on vacation?
So that we can account for it.
The only thing that would actually require is between being on the phone for is an active vote of the board.
Okay.
And keep in mind, as Ms. Segarra and others have alluded to, this can be done at town meeting. This can be done by this board alone. This board will have to make a decision on how you feel you want to proceed, but anything submitted in writing to the secretary would be appropriate to be compiled and then to be considered by the board at the next meeting.
As a vote.
And it would not necessarily, the other thing that it would seem to me people seem to forget frequently that if you called in and just wanted to vote on that and then for whatever reason had to partake and go do something else, there's no requirement just as a member attending a meeting that might have somewhere they have to be or come late for
I just want to be able to find a landline.
Understood, but
so
what I'm saying is it's also not required to sit there for the duration of a meeting.
Okay.
If a person needed to do one thing and then step away, that would be appropriate, nor is it illegal.
Okay.
So the fact you could, be out of state is a qualifying
that's
factor
what I'll do.
To remote right. participation.
Because so I'd like the board to be unanimous.
Yes,
I would like us to stand unanimous
yes,
on this
if
one.
You can do that, you've got 22, I think, 22 yes
22.
And no.
Yep.
there, so if you want to go over it.
The brand new sheet she just gave me, the update.
Perfect.
Yes.
So without any further ado, Cheryl, thank you very much for coming. We greatly appreciate it.
And I have that date on. Okay. And I'm assuming you would vote, and then you would want me, I'm assuming, to draft a proposed regulation.
Yes,
and
the
then
board
you
would like that.
Hold a public hearing.
Yes, please.
Correct.
Okay. Yes, yes.
Okay. And after the public hearing, obviously, you can make, you don't have to vote on exactly what was proposed if you change your mind.
Right.
And then we have to go through the particulars in regards to how notice is given.
I can work with that. With
exactly,
this.
And what
however,
that time frame would be. Okay, perfect.
Because
yes.
Obviously, there's a certain time frame of appropriateness to notify
right.
retailers of any changes that might be made to give them time to train staff to come into compliance.
Yeah.
Right.
Great. Thank you, Cheryl. Appreciate it.
Are we dismissed?
You
we're
can.
Dismissed.
You can. And I don't want to leave anyone out. I would like to have Ms. Bettencourt
yes.
come forward.
Could you excuse me just 1 second?
Sure.
Thank you.
Would you like me to...
You can keep...
I can keep
yes.
going?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have a question.
I'm going to take a short bathroom break.
Nice to meet you. Are you a new member?
Okay. You want a break?
Yeah, can you? We're on a break.
It's
can is that
you
is that off?
Of the room. She'll share one teeny tiny bit of insight from having what we just went over in Whitman, if you're open to it. If not, that's fine.
Smoking ashes.
This is
smoking
ashes. Angela,
oh.
Lisa,
no.
Lisa. Okay. Let me go back. So just the red button.
Yep.
Okay. So we are back from our bathroom break. Please come forward.
Okay.
The light's on, right?
Yes, the red light is on.
Okay. Thank you for your time, first off. I don't know if everyone heard me state to Mr. Fine that I'm with Burke Enterprises. We have the mobile station on 139 right by Stop and Shop. I will tell you this, I've worked for Burke for 19 years. I started at the age of 20, and it's a great company, and that's what keeps me there. I know... Cheryl, I believe was her first name, shared a lot of stories about the big tobacco companies. And I think that they've changed the way that they operate over the years. And I don't know that statement from that R.J. Reynolds rap, if it was true or something that's put out there. I'm not saying she told a falsehood, but there's a lot of negative publicity around tobacco. And there's still a lot of, you know, negative stuff associated with smoking. No one should pick up a cigarette or any tobacco, but I still believe a person has the right to make the health decision. You know, just because something isn't good for somebody doesn't mean we can ban sorts of it. You know, I happen to love chocolate chip cookies. Are we going to take those off the market? I might weigh 15 pounds less if we did, but there comes a point when we can no longer oversee and big brother everyone. You know, as long as you're an adult, whether the age is 18 or 21, you know, where my point with big tobacco was, it's the retailers you need, you know. Mr. Lane was 100% right. You know, even if, say, big tobacco is out to hook those minors, we're not. Because what happens, we lose our license, we get negative publicity. And I will tell you this, you do not want to be the store that sold cigarettes to a minor. There's a negative connotation, you lose your license, everyone comes in and your cigarette racks are empty. Everybody knows what you did. They don't like you, because it could have been their kid. So nobody wants to do that. What I want to do is work with the towns and different organizations. You know, if you choose 21, I support that. But I believe if you make the age 21, so you should not restrict flavors of tobacco. And I know she referenced aggressive, marketing. In a C store meaning convenience store.
Mm-hmm.
I honestly, you know, my company, I can't speak for everyone else. We don't have any outside signs. And we keep, all there is prices in front of product. You know, we're not saying, hey kids, come and look at me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are adults that do like flavored cigars. You know, and I believe if you are 21, you go ahead, or 18, as long as you are legally to have that product. But we can't force people to do what's right for them. Again, I go back to my cookie scenario.
recently the town of Randolph made the decision to go to the age of 21. What they did is they did held an education hearing for people, that retail is in that town. And I know that towns, you know, back in 2000, the state of Massachusetts had nearly $60 million to work with for a smoking cessation program. Now it's less than $4 million for the state. It's $3.8 million. Drastic budget cut, but you know, when we talk about the FDA compliances, they're doing the checks. You have to use that. Towns are cutting back on those. How can you say minors are getting a product if you're not checking? It's a blanket statement to, and no disrespect, but it's a blanket statement to enforce the smoking decline because they don't have the resources to do their job and do compliance checks. The state has put you guys in a terrible position, I believe. They have not come forward and made the regulation 21. It's been on their table for a year and a half, maybe two, and they haven't talked about flavors or anything. And they're trying to go to individual towns and force them to play big brother when they're not willing to do it. But again, I come down to the point of, you can't force everyone to do something or not do something. If it is 21, then if you believe the person is of sound mind and body and can make that decision, why are we going to ban flavors? And if you take them out of a convenience store that is not aggressively marketing them to youth, you're giving an unfair competitive advantage. So then do you just ban them all together? You know, why, when I run a good business, should I not be allowed to sell something that isn't banned by the state or the federal government? It just seems a little unfair to me.
So I'm going to ask a question. Flavor seems to be the big stumbling block, I think, for a lot of the people who have come before us and have spoken. And I just want to note that town resident has come forward to speak on this, and we've been talking about this for the last three meetings. 18 to 21, it's a two-year difference. Three-year difference. Three-year difference. Changing a law, raising it from 18 to 21, what are you going to lose in sales?
I would.
Flavors staying, take out, I'm looking for two different answers. Flavors in, flavors out. Three-year age group.
I would say maybe 2%, if that.
Yeah.
If you go to a flavor restriction, it would be, and I can speak of this because we have several, we operate in 22 different cities and towns in the state of Massachusetts and two sites in New Hampshire. It would be closer to 40%. And the worst thing, and when you do that, is you're not only taking business from me, if the town doesn't have, say, an adult-only facility, people are buying it online. It's like, it just, and then there's no age verification, so I feel like you put it in the worst position, unintentionally, of course. But if you were to go 21 and not, you know, because I feel like the flavor ban I mentioned is wrong, in my opinion, you know, it's just forcing people to make a decision. But the other thing that's wrong is minimum pricing. If you say something that should only cost, you know, $1.50, we're going to make it be $3, $5. It's just taking more money from the adult consumer that has to worry about paying for their kids' basketball or soccer and other household expenses. I just think it costs the consumer more money. I mean, I should like it in the sense that I make more money then, but I don't feel bad. I don't feel good about taking more than what's needed.
Okay. All right. Have any more questions? Because I would like to allow Lisa the final
and I will be very
blurb
for you.
Thank you for coming.
That was very.
Thank you very much.
Very informative.
We appreciate
thank you very
you
much.
You did very well.
I'm sorry
yes.
I go all over the place.
That's okay.
Nervous.
No, you did fine.
And please don't ban Oreo cookies.
Oh, God.
Chocolate
chips. All right. What do you got?
So, Whitman. Went through the change, banned flavors to all but adult-only establishments, which made us, at that time, the only game in town. Great for us, completely opposed to it. It's not fair business. It would not be fair business to say, flavors can be sold at Smoke and Ashes and Brennan's, and all of the hardworking people who mm-hmm. have put their whole life into whether it's a mom and pop convenience or it's a Cumberland Farms can't have that product. It's not the right thing to do. It's not fair business. We would totally be opposed to that. The way that it was solved in Whitman was that the law had to be rewritten, go to another meeting, and they kind of just made gentlemen's agreement. If you're not 18 plus, let's not frontline the product. Can we all agree to do that? Everybody agreed to do that. It has not been an issue. So I would just kind of put that out there. I can promise you, if you say adult only, you're going to have a very full room of all of your other convenience and mom and pops mm-hmm. who are not going to be happy with you about that. Because it's handing the business to me. Mm-hmm. It's great for me, but it's not the right thing to do.
Okay. Lisa, the past is sometimes a good predictor of the future, and sometimes it isn't. All I'm going to tell you is just look what the board did 2 years ago. We took into account the mom and pop stores, the Cumberland Farms, and flavors were not banned from those stores. What will happen 2 weeks from now, I don't know, but...
Just trying to save you the backlash.
Yeah. We don't mind backlash, that's why we're here.
Can I make a final comment?
I don't know, Dennis.
Oh, come on.
One minute. Go.
I just want to talk to you, and I 100% agree with what this young lady said. I'm very proud of her. There's a phenomenon in retailing called the market basket. He's looking at his watch. Come on, we're both in Quincy. you know, there's a phenomenon called market basket, and I'm one of the highest volume milk stores in the system, and 63% of people who buy milk in my store buy cigarettes, but that's not what I'm getting at. Every product has a market basket. So if you take those flavors and send them to an adult-only store, they end up getting a Visi cooler full of Coke, bottled water, they got a candy rack in front of the counter. Mm. When someone who's looking for a pineapple-flavored game and they're of legal age comes in and I don't have it, I lose the Snickers, I lose the lottery, I lose the cup of coffee, I lose the newspaper. I lose more than $1.49, so I just want you to think about that. And that's how I pay my employees.
Point taken. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you for your generosity.
You are quite welcome. Right. Okay. I'm going to close the discussion. We have agreed to go over the list that Cheryl has given us. And right now, if we want to, let's continue with number 4 on the town government study. Committee. This was something that we were all supposed to look at. We've gotten through 1 through 3. We are picking up with number 4. What do you see as gaps in your department, board, or committee's service to the community? The answer that we have here is at this time, there are no proactive improvements in the Board of Health initiatives. We are 100% reactive. Does anybody disagree with that statement? Or have something else they would like to add to number 4? Or are we accepting it as is? I would say that we are 100% proactive. We are trying to make a difference. I would hope that we could continue moving forward.
Can I ask you a question, Madam Chair?
I
came in a little late, so I apologize if my question is redundant. Could you just state what's our purpose of going through all of the bullet items? I mean,
these are the ones that Lisa,
right.
She took a first stab at it. We were all going to read it and go over it, and we were going to make sure that we didn't have anything to add. I'm going through each question. So far, we've accepted the answers for 1, 2, and 3.
Okay. I just had a different interpretation from our 2 weeks ago at our meeting. I thought all the points were excellent, and I thought, and correct me if I'm wrong, I thought that we as a board agreed that if we had anything to add, we were going to submit them to the health agent, and she was going to add them to the report. So I'm certainly not saying this is a waste of time. I just didn't know that we'd be going over all the items.
Well, I did not change anything.
And I didn't either.
No, nothing's been changed.
Okay.
None of us.
So, all right, so... Then it is safe to assume that we can make a, can, would you like to make a motion to accept it as is and have it submitted?
Sure. I mean, I don't want to prevent,
nope.
Again, I might
Great.
Have missed something.
Nope, that's okay.
Okay. So in looking at the town government study, I'd like to make a motion on, I'd like to make a motion that we accept the report as written.
Excuse me, just one second. I am so sorry,
Gary. Go ahead.
On number two, there was one thing that we had to modify, and it was where Sheila was on the food chain. She was missing off of where her job description fell under the category of the government.
Okay.
That has to be corrected. So could you make a motion where number two would be corrected to include Sheila?
Sure. So I will revise my motion that
I'm sorry.
I started. That's okay. I'll make a motion that we accept the report as prepared by the Board of Health as is, with the exception of adding the changes to number two, adding our administrator's role as secretary, but that we can submit this report to the town government committee as is.
Do I hear a second?
I will second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Done. Well, they're going to be very happy.
Very good. Thank you, Gary.
Okay. Sorry about that.
Nope. No worries. Right on to cannabis. Still stay up.
Are we still there?
Yeah,
he's gonna update for
us. We I did update the board when we met 3 weeks ago, and the cannabis committee, it was actually a great meeting, and I won't be redundant, but we came up with a course of action that we are going to be presenting something at town meeting. So the board, the cannabis committee, is not going to be meeting until after town meeting.
Okay.
So
okay.
So nothing has changed. It should be an interesting town meeting when that comes up for discussion. I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, perfect. Moving right along to the plastic bag monkey survey. So last we met, we were given Plymouth, Dennis, and one other town's final draft of their VN on articles. Is it Dennis, Lisa?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay. Dennis, Plymouth, and something somewhere else.
Sandwich?
In the North Shore?
No. It was Cape and Island.
Sandwich?
Cape and Island.
Why am I?
Okay. With that being said, we had final drafts. We also had five questions that had been brought up. We had thoughts on the survey, which was options 1, 2, and 3. And then we also had five questions. If everybody has what I have, just to make sure.
Yes, ma'am.
Five questions in regards to what we could develop to be put up on a survey for you for banning single-use plastic bags at retail and food establishments. Does anybody disagree with these five questions, agree with all five, or have anything they would like to add or change?
If I can make a couple of comments, Madam Chair.
And
Lisa, thank you for putting these together and taking into account our input. On Survey Monkey, because I'm familiar with the technology from a broad level, but I'm not familiar with SurveyMonkey. So the way that this sheet was designed, it looks like after number five, there's a comment section. So on the five questions, when you put them out there, you simply, it's a yes or a no, there's, the comment is simply at the end.
Yes.
Okay, the only thing that I'm just gonna throw out there, and it's I'm not, you know, married to it, but I like all the questions. I would like to see number 4 and 5 flipped. I feel that the question number 5, which is one of the ones that I gave you, is more, it's kind of tied into questions 1, 2, and 3, and I feel the styrofoam, not that it stands alone and not that it's unimportant, and my fellow board members may disagree. I'm just throwing it out there for my 2 cents.
I'm not sure that, you know, in staying consistent, maybe as someone is reading the questions, you know, it talks about a ban, it talks about the plastic bags, it talks about smaller businesses, then it goes into the fee, and then the styrofoam.
Mm.
I don't have a problem flipping them. I don't think it makes a difference, but I don't have a problem flipping them. I think that all, my opinion is, I feel that we are asking the people of Pembroke what their thoughts are in regards to this. As long as we get it out there, I actually saw one, a SurveyMonkey that was put out by PEC TV, I believe, in regards to internet or Comcast or fuzziness or something that I saw on the website a couple of days ago. But I would like to make a motion that we will accept flipping 5 for 4 and putting styrofoam as the last as number 5.
I'll second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So if we can get that up or however that goes about,
I send that over to Deborah Wall and she then takes it from there. She
perfect.
Actually controls and operates the service.
How long do you usually put it out there for, Lisa?
I go with her recommendation as she is basically not written the surveys that have been done in the town so far, but certainly architected them and put them up. I trust her good judgment.
Who is?
Deborah Wall,
oh.
Our head librarian.
No, yeah, I didn't hear you.
She controls and operates a lot of our media accounts because of her expertise in the area.
Okay, then moving right along, job description for the health agent. We have been given revised as of January 24th, 2017.
With
2-page document.
Where was that one? I have the one that I had was 2000.
Yeah, it was revised down the bottom. Because things changed under her job description.
I'll make a copy.
Yes, please. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for indulging me and letting me change that.
Sorry, Sheila. You know, that's the kind of gal I am.
Yeah.
Do you have
I know you've given me.
I have the blank. I don't know why she sent them to us, but yes, I do have them.
You have this.
Paid on something that is updated.
You know what? I actually don't. Thank you. Actually don't know. And I printed.
Okay, because this was something that Gail handed out.
Oh, tonight?
Months ago.
Oh,
no, yeah.
Oh, it wasn't included in an attachment.
No.
Oh, okay.
I actually organized everything so that I had it all together, and it was actually given out the same night as the.
So I don't. If it wasn't part of the attachments, I do not have that with me this evening.
Okay. It was part of a previous
misunderstood your question.
Packet that was given out.
Okay.
Okay, so I will keep this as the chair and we'll go off of that in case something comes up. So we are dealing with the health, Board of Health. We have agreed and we hope that you'll accept our contract to continue being the Pembroke Health Agent. But now we are looking at a revised copy as of January 24th, 2017, that has all your duties listed. Are there, since this was written, anything added or deleted that we should be advised of?
No,
we're only looking at 4 weeks.
There isn't, but there's something that the board should consider here, and this is completely at the will of the board. It is my opinion, and only my opinion, that people are getting very bogged down in the minutiae of a job description. And I cannot stress enough that a health agent position, I've talked to many of my counterparts in other towns, the way you choose to use this position varies a lot from town to town.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's your core things, your, if you would, obvious things. Your Title V, your perk test, your restaurant inspections, there's the obvious. But in most communities, the position is also used to do other things. Now, that's at the will of the board, and I'm going to give a for example. Let's for example this. Furnace pond dredging project. Strictly speaking, if one were to read my job description right now, I'm under no obligation to lend any assistance to that project at all. However, is that in the best interest of the residents of the town of Pembroke? Considering that I'm one of the most knowledgeable people in the town of Pembroke about the watersheds that reside in this town. I personally, as a citizen and taxpayer, would say no, of course that's foolish. You do not deny the town access to a resource that will lend good information to it. Another area of concern for a lot of residents in the town, again, not part of my job description, would be the 40B project currently under review for Water Street. Am I under any obligation to answer questions beyond the scope of septic regarding that plan. No, I'm not. However, having been intimately involved with the licensing and the whole process regarding Copperwood, obviously I have a lot of experience to offer on that particular project. However, as you write a job description, there's no way for the three members of this board to possibly predict what's going to come across the threshold of the town of Pembroke in the future. Some cities and towns have their health agent be strictly a by-the-book inspector. There's nothing wrong with that. They inspect restaurants, they inspect septic systems, they do sanitary complaints, and that's it. There's nothing wrong with that approach. And if that's the will of the board, keep in mind, it's up to the three of you, then that's the will of the board. So be it, until for some reason that changes. How you want to use your resources up to you. The only thing I would warn the board is you get into a little bit of a gray area when you start putting things in black and white and say this is all that it is, then that's all that it is. So I just think the board should think about that a little bit. By all means, expand it, detract from it as the board sees fit. But keep in mind, you can't predict the future either. And you don't want to, if you would, write things out or cross things off and then find out, well, geez, I don't know if that was the best decision on behalf of the 20,000 residents. Having said all that, I couldn't write one effectively. You want the true answer? I took my best stab at it based on what my day-to-day activity looks like, but I'm not going to be able to predict. Who would predict that a 40B application would come in on the shores of the North River? I would never have predicted that. But nonetheless, here we are today, and I find myself, you know, doing public records requests to find out what endangered species are out there and things like that, because that falls under my skill set. Is it strictly my job? No, of course not. Is it in the best interest of 20,000 residents? In my opinion, yeah, it is in the best interest to use your best resources when projects like that enter the community. But again, it's the will of the board. Rewrite it, change it, delete it, add to it. That's the will of you.
Are you happy with, you know, having putting it down? I know that there were some things taken away in regards to the IT.
Mm-hmm.
There were some other things. Something that I have said previously is that we are a small town with very
limited resources
and money. So you being able to come on board and to add any opinion or history in regards to any aspect, to me is just, it's priceless. I wish more people felt that way. You know, it's not in my job description.
Well, and that's a discussion that has been had at some department head meetings. And there is concern when it comes down to, that's not my job, or that's not my job description, or that's not my responsibility. And actually, one of the nicest things that's ever been said about me, Mr. Thorne was having a meeting with two of the members of the Board of Selectmen regarding exactly that issue they were having in another area. And unfortunately, there was something that had come up. I needed to speak to the town administrator and to Selectman Stone. I unfortunately had to interrupt them to have a quick discussion. And Ed Thorne stopped his meeting with Mr. Stone and another selectman and said, and that's one of the few employees in this town you will never hear those words from. And I said, I'm sorry, gentlemen, I don't know what you're talking about. And they said, that's one of the few employees that you'll never say, that's not my job and it's not my responsibility. Humbly, I'll say to you, I don't think there's anything that if I have expertise on, if I am acted to act upon it, that it is not my job to 20,000 taxpayers in this town, that if I have knowledge, experience, or otherwise an advantageous position to add on behalf of 20,000 taxpayers, the fact that it is not my job has never entered in the equation for me. The only thing I'll say to back that up is I can't do everything. I have the same 40 hours a week that every other worker in this building has, and at some point, there's a tipping point at which not everything can be done by one person either. So I try to prioritize what are the things that certainly I as a taxpayer and what I think based on what I'm hearing from the public at large are the most important things that I should be focusing on and doing. And I try to prioritize that way. But again, this is your department, folks. You're the board. If you make other decisions, I fully encourage you to do so. I will follow the instructions as the board has set forth.
All right, with that being said, Lisa, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Would anybody like to take this have any thoughts, statements? Because I don't have any.
The only thing that I'd really like to see with this is I'd like to see that one of the things that that bothers me about this is that we're actually hiring people to do the inspections, the food inspections, where we're lending out our health agent. $50 a pop to do a food inspection from an outside identity is definitely putting a financial burden on the Board of Health. I'd like to see if there's some way that we can correct that. I do understand how busy the Board of Health is and the many identities that it does carry. But I would like to make sure that we're just completely informed with where we're supposed to be and then be able to branch out after that. I mean, as far as certainly the more knowledge we can get as a department or a town, the more that people can share with experience is only beneficial to us. But I do have concerns as far as the budget and how the budget is being played with us actually hiring outside people to do our food inspections.
Well, I don't know if that's ever been brought up in regards to the budget. I mean, I don't think our budget has changed.
No.
The Board of Health without the increase of salary to the secretary and to the health agent. I would be very hard pressed to think.
Where is the funding coming for the nurses? Is that coming out of our permitting?
It's nurses and inspectional services, and it's the same $20,000 awarded to us by town meeting, my very first town meeting after hired as agent, and we have never exceeded that $20,000. In fact, we usually turn back about $5,000 of it every year. So we are well under budget for our inspectional services as well as our nursing services.
But we're still paying, when they go out on inspection, we're still paying them $50 per inspection.
Correct.
Okay.
And we have a proctor, a ServSafe proctor, that is used, and a registered RN. It's not only performing, or please correct me if I'm wrong, it's not only, first of all, how many establishments, including the schools, are there on the list? There's 100. So if you have to do 200 of them a year.
Yep.
Okay.
At approximately 2 hours a piece.
2 hours a piece.
Twice a year.
Twice a year.
Yep.
Okay. That pretty much would...
400 man hours. 10 weeks of time.
10 weeks of time.
It's just
correct.
From September.
Okay.
Just money-wise, September. It's cheaper to outsource it.
That's what I always thought.
Can you repeat that, please?
It's cheaper to outsource it at a flat fee of $50 an inspection. If the inspection lasts for an hour to 2 hours, you would pay Lisa more to do one than you would if you did a flat rate of $50.
And they also can answer any ill-born illness complaints because they are a ServSafe proctor as well as an RN and assist and instruct with the regulations and keep track of the problems until they're in compliance. So that means that the proctor, these outside inspections that are being done by the
RN... These two women are more qualified than I am.
Okay.
Point blank, when it comes to ServSafe, they're both more experienced and more qualified. Nancy Funder has been an inspector and a public health nurse for over 20 years, I dare say over 25. Now she's going to watch this and she's going to say I'm calling her old and she's going to get very angry at me. And Kathy DeBimont-Ponte has been a proctor for years. So in areas, in this particular area, I would say both of these women are more qualified for me. But something for the board to consider, totally respect that it's money spent, but what Ms. Landy is saying is accurate. Most of these inspections or over an hour, it could be as long as two. And yes, $50 an inspection is a sum of money spent. Keep in mind, under my compensation package, if you break it down, I'm paid over $29 an hour by the town, plus benefits. Round that casually to about $40 an hour is what I'm worth to the town of Pembroke in my capacity. So if I was to do the same inspection, the amount invested by Pembroke in me doing it would be more money per inspection than the $50 flat with no benefits, no additional funds. Having said all that, there's no reason why we can't. We could eliminate the specters completely, and I can go back to doing all the ServSafe inspections. But again, this is 10 weeks of time, 400 man hours, 2.5 months, that I will not be in this office. one of the mandates from the Board of Selectmen is they want all these offices open. Sheila Landy and I work very closely together when she, you know, goes to lunch or has a reason she needs to leave medically, whatever the reason is that the office will be closed. I make every effort to physically be here, barring already being scheduled out of this office or an emergency occurring. So take back those hours. What I'm saying is we're rapidly running out of hours. I can do this, and I'm happy to do it, and I have no problem with doing it. We will then have to cross some other those things off that list that will not get done, that I will not have time left to do. And just as another point of interest, many towns, and towns much smaller than ours, when we talk about having a full-time health agent, I'll use Halifax, right next door. Town of Halifax has less than half the food service establishments we do. The town of Halifax has a full-time health agent. The town of Halifax uses Kathy DeVide-Montponte, which is how I met her, to do their food inspections. They have already determined a town with two-thirds of the population of ours and less than half the food service businesses that they cannot accomplish it at all. Honestly, we were one of the last towns to start subbing out. The towns that haven't subbed it out also have a health director as well as a health agent. In other words, the health director's handling, for example, the budget, emergency management, any internal operations of the office, which I am doing both. For example, Duxbury and Marshfield both have public health directors in addition to their health agents. Again, totally up to the board. We can eliminate that money spent. I can go ahead and do those inspections, but we will be taking other things off the list that I will then no longer have time to do, and I have no problem with that.
Well, I've read through the list, and I don't know if there's anything that can be taken off the list, if that was to be a change. Gary?
My initial reaction to the topic that Ms. McSweeney raised about eliminating the outsource of the food inspections, my initial reaction based upon what I've heard this evening, and again, initial reaction would be it probably wouldn't be prudent. That being said, I think it's prudent upon the board to every now and then step back and give it some real thought and say what re-engineering or process improvements could be made. So again, I'm inclined to think that it probably makes sense to continue doing what we're doing. That being said though, I would like to make a motion to table the suggestion that Ms. McSweeney made for our next meeting, and we could maybe have a little bit heartier discussion, because if we did decide to do it, and again, I am inclined to think we shouldn't, but if we're inclined to do it, I think it should merit a more lengthy than a 5-minute discussion this evening when it's kind of being brought up for the first time.
Correct.
So I would like to make a motion that we table that and put it on our next agenda to have a more robust discussion.
Excuse me, Clerk Fine, could I make a motion? Could I ask that we move it to...
I put a motion on the floor, so it has to now be...
To April 10th.
I think I can help both of you. Stop. You made a motion to postpone. You'd like to postpone it to a date certain, which is totally appropriate.
A date that I'm going to come.
No, and that's fine.
That I'll be here April 10th.
No, but that's totally appropriate. Okay. And keep in mind, unless this displeases the board, between now and then, as far as I know, as an employee, I'm still operating under those set of guidelines.
Yes.
So unless there's if there's an urgent need to change it immediately, I will operate under those guidelines, and then when the board revisits it. So you made a motion to postpone. Do you want to say the date certain?
Yes, I would like to say April 10th.
So
that
Mr.
will be the
Fine,
next meeting
okay
that will be
the
available.
Amendment to your motion?
Sure.
I'm just trying to help you with points of business. I'm just trying to.
Sure.
Okay.
So you're going to second his motion with your.
I am going to second Mr. Fine's motion.
But you won't be here this. So you're going to miss 2 meetings?
No, I'm going to be here April 10th. I'm missing
March.
The 13th, and
yeah,
I'll be
the 27th.
Here. Oh, I will.
You do have the 27th.
I will be back the 27th.
Yes, I don't want to wait till April.
Oh, no. Okay, I'm sorry. I confused myself.
No worries. 27th, please.
Things will happen. So we're going to alter. So you're going to retract your original statement. Now you're going to move your.
We're going to go back to the 27th.
Mr. Fine, does that work for you?
It does.
So you have a motion and it's seconded.
May I have a second?
Yep. Well, Gail would have seconded with her amendment.
All in favor?
All right. There we go. Now you got.
Okay.
In the interim, Lisa and Sheila.
Yes, sir.
if there's any statistical information, either pro or con, and you've given your feelings now, but if you have anything that will help support your argument, it would be greatly appreciated.
I don't have an argument. I'm going to be very clear about this. I don't have an argument. I'm happy to do the food inspections. I just want the three of you to understand that means I'm not physically in this office for an additional 400 hours, and as Sheila can tell you, Sheila, ballpark it, at least 10 people today. I sat and went through a file. They're either purchasing a home, selling a home, Title V questions, look at this with me and everything else.
That's going to get, I understand that's going to get a lot busier because, well, March, it depends the weather, but April.
That. I won't be here for that. If I'm going to be out in the field an additional 400 hours plus drive time, I have no problem with that, but that means the citizens that normally only miss me in the morning, and they've kind of learned, they come in the afternoon more, that only miss me for the septic inspections or the morning perk tests. Now I'm going to be out a lot of afternoons too. I have no problem with that. I'm happy to do it, but we need to understand that there's going to be a customer service impact to this, and there are other things that are going to have to come off the plate to accommodate those 400 hours. I have no problem. That's completely and 100% the board's decision. You need to decide how your resources are spent. The only flip side of that I'll give you is I went out and got you the two best resources I could humanly find for the money to do these inspections, and both of them have long-standing track records. One, obviously, the town of Hanover. The other, obviously, the town of Halifax. I didn't invent the wheel. I'm not going to lie. I stole the best wheel I could find. So that's what I did.
And the other thing that we also have to look at is we are, spring is coming.
If it's anything like that, last year we are going to be absolutely buried. Last year was the busiest year in 7 years.
The health agent will be out doing perks and Title V inspections at least two a day. Then we're going to roll right along into the ponds opening.
Yep.
We will be into testing.
We will have a lot of fun ahead of us.
We have a lot of, you know, so basically I would think looking at this list, let's come back and what 4 to 5 responsibilities could you in fact delete off our table to make up for those 400 hours?
We'll have that discussion.
We will have that discussion on the 27th.
Okay. Are we still on the job description?
Because we're done.
I'd like to weigh in on the job description.
Okay.
I didn't have an opportunity. I was speaking to...
The floor is yours,
thank you.
Mr. Fine.
Okay. Lisa, it was. Mm-hmm. I certainly don't think it was a PR puff piece, but it was nice to hear you articulate your modus operandi around town hall. And in the time that I've known you and the time that I've been here, I would echo those sentiments. I've been frustrated on the board with the discussion of the job description. I have been saying since day one that the job description, and I didn't coin this phrase, but it's a living, breathing document, and that's how the board need, in my opinion, I'm speaking for myself, that's how the board needs to take it. Now, the job description should be looked at, and I think on my coming up on my first 3 years on the board of health, I think I would like to almost put in place, certainly not once a month, but maybe once every 3 months, that we need to spend 5 minutes or so going through your job description and seeing if it could be tweaked. Because in my first 3 years, that isn't something, I haven't looked at this document. So
yep.
I think in the spirit of keeping it a living, breathing document, we should look at it more frequently, and maybe it can go on the agenda once every 3 months and we can talk about it for a few minutes. But taking it a step further, I think you do a very good job at keeping us informed. And I don't know every town employee here, but I would say that, not that you're one of the better ones, but you're one of the ones who would say that wouldn't say that's not in my job description.
I'm
sorry.
I'm getting laughed at by you.
I just thought it was funny.
You can move,
John.
I'm just kidding. I'm joking. I'm sorry.
I'm giving you props here.
No, thank you. However,
there have been times where, because of your ability and your willingness and your resource, knowledge, intellectual capital, you've been asked to do things that occasionally the board has found out secondhand. So I guess this really not as a critique, but I'd like to ask you, when you're being pulled in a different direction, that you are quick to inform the board. I'm just going to give you an example. Our last recycling project. And prior to the way the board looks now, our board looked different before Ms. Sweeney was here. And I think that recycling was a little bit of a sensitive topic for some that are no longer here in terms of the amount of resources that you spent on it. So it wasn't always, I felt, brought to our fullest attention what you were doing. I remember when, if I weren't a board member and if I didn't actively read the Pembroke Mariner, I may not have been as abreast on this, the new curbside program. So I guess while we're talking about job description, I'm just going to sneak in the very slightest of digs. If you could just, going forward, just make sure that you're informing the board when you're asked to do an additional project.
I 100% agree. That's why I brought Furnace Pond and the 40B project to the board at the last meeting. You'll remember I brought up and said, is it appropriate, and so on and so forth. I happen to agree with your assessment, and that's why I did that.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Nice point taken. Anything else?
I'll get off my hobby horse.
Anything else in regards to this job description? If not, we will pick it up and address
on the
food inspection services. The last point, we're all done with old business, so we're on to new business. Food service regulations, presentation of documentation by
McSweeney.
McSweeney.
Those were the FDA and the Serv Safe, and you got all the literature.
Are you making a presentation?
I have all the.
No, I'm not making a presentation.
But can I ask? Well, we got this information.
Right.
Can I ask why this documentation was submitted?
How it's pertained? Well.
Yeah, that's where my confusion lies.
We're going a little bit backwards. The FDA is the one that's in charge. Food and Drug Administration is the one that's in charge.
Of what?
Of the food and drug for federal government. Okay, and then they oversee the states and tell the states exactly what their criterias are, like such as Massachusetts was a certification.
Yep.
And it's just information and it's literature for you to understand more how the process works from the federal government to the state government.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
That's basically what that's about.
Okay,
and the requirements, and as you know, this branches off. I mean, everything that we pretty much do has a branch to it, or
correct.
Tentacles.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, or tributaries.
But this gives you,
a lesson on the law.
Well, it just gives you insight to how we're performing.
Well, let me ask you a quick, did you think that we didn't understand?
No, I just think that there's some gaps. And there's a lot of information when you're dealing with the federal government and the state government together. There are always a lot of gaps. I've always found that when I worked for Medicare, that there were always attachments that go to it. It's like a law. We have one law, and then they make 15 amendments on it.
Exactly. And then there's no enactment, and then there's...
Correct.
Get in front of the Senate.
Right.
But yes.
This is just basic information.
Exactly. And I have read...
Okay.
I will confirm that I have read and highlighted every single portion of this. I've also looked at the food prediction policies. I just want to make sure that we have put anything having to do with the Mass Department and the federal level to bed.
We're in state compliance now with the state, right? As far as giving them our
correct, because
food
we
reports.
Are now finally on their list. We got dropped somehow.
Yep.
That list has been filled out for 2015. It is going to be filled out for 2016.
I have not yet been contacted.
Okay.
2016.
So we're still waiting for that form to come from the...
I know that Brandy Hopkins has both my email and Lisa's.
Lisa's, okay.
And
that will be done.
And she said we were added to the database, so when they issue it, then we'll take care of it.
Yeah.
So I want to make sure that we no longer are in confusion or disagreement in regards to the statement of when the establishments were done, 11 by Lisa, including 4 or 5 which were of the schools, that those are not still considered illegal inspections. We're not going to pay to have anyone go out and re-inspect. We're going to move forward.
Madam Chair, I need to understand from you why you're bringing up this in a derogatory manner. This is something to be addressed, and right now all you keep doing is reiterating the fact that the inspections weren't done with under a certification. Okay, this was my only address, that we run under the law and that we run legal in this Board of Health.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, to me at this point it feels that you're taking somewhat of a reprimanding tone, and I really don't appreciate that on trying to protect the residents and the public safety of this town.
Well, what I'm trying to state is the fact that you have presented 2 forms of valuable information and documentation. Is this being, I need to understand whether we are all set, or do we need to put on the agenda for our next meeting that we consider having the 11 establishments reinspected, or are we in agreement that this is done because it's an interpretation?
This
is an interpretation.
This is going to follow through.
And I know it was very important for you. You went out.
This is important to me.
I know it's important to you, which is
the health
and
safety of the residents is extremely important to me. Right now, I did get my request from the town clerk's office on the food records.
Yep.
I need to review them. I think to even speak prior to even looking at them would be foolish.
So then I'm going to assume that we are not done with this yet, that once you have reviewed the documentation that you're referring to, that we may be coming back to this.
Correct.
Okay. That's all I want to clarify.
Okay.
Because my job, it's cast that I set an agenda so that we can discuss the majority of topics that we need to discuss for the people of Pembroke, for what we were hired to do.
I fully agree with that.
Okay. So we have done a great job moving forward with a lot of things that were asked. I'm sorry if you took my tone in a derogatory statement, but I think that where we've spent so much time on this, that there may be information that you further want to look at, that it's important that we slate it for what we're going to start covering, because we've got to get through where we're at and move forward. That's all I'm trying to set. I want to lay the groundwork so that we can address topics that are important to all of us. With that being said, I'm done. That's all.
I don't know if I should call this ServSafe gate or not, but we as a board, as far as I'm concerned, have moved beyond ServSafe. I mean, Gail has done, Ms. McSweeney has done a lot of research, presented documentation. I almost take these health inspections, and I almost liken it to one of our earlier topics this evening when we were talking about T21. Clearly the state is asking towns to do things that the state doesn't want to do, and we're having to interpret the law and come up with our own set of laws. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not an attorney. I do work in law, and you know, I can find a mass general law that contradicts and supports a certain argument, and there's all kinds of documentation out there. As far as the health inspection, as far as I'm concerned, it's incumbent upon the board, the three of us, to interpret how these inspections should be done. Mm-hmm. And as far as I'm concerned, and I'm not sure what records request I don't know what we're talking about. But as far as the Board of Health goes, as far as I'm concerned, this is a done topic. We're done. Lisa, you're ServSafe certified. You don't have to, that's not a question. And we're moving forward as we always have. Well, we reserve the right to take a look at the process going forward, but we're done. Am I missing something?
Well,
I don't know.
Have you ever reviewed an inspection?
I've gone out and done
inspections. You've gone out. Have you ever reviewed the inspections?
The inspection that I went out on the health agent, yes, but that, I don't know.
That's once, Gary. Have you ever reviewed the inspection forms?
Yes, I have. Have I studied them to the extent that you have? Probably not. You seem very passionate about this. And I'm
pretty astute about
and,
it.
Well, you're, you,
Let's
you
put
say
it that
astute,
way.
I would say passionate, but that,
well,
that's okay.
Well, that's a difference of opinion as well.
Yep, but I think we're done with ServSafe. I mean, if it's going to come up again, you reserve the right to bring it up again as an agenda item mm-hmm. and submit it through the chair.
Correct.
But, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
So you think we are, I'm not quite sure, and Gail isn't quite sure.
Okay.
At this point. So time will only tell. I just want to make sure that we have it in our agenda process for the next at least 3 or 4 months, that it may be coming up again. So hold on to your information. We can't put it to bed yet. Just a reminder, we are having the annual town meeting warrant is open as of the 13th of February. It will be closing on March 3rd. I believe that we do have a article up. It's in regards to amending the...
just to remove livestock.
To exclude livestock permits.
From license withholders for those with outstanding fees to the town, correct.
And we are going to hold our next Board of Health meeting on Monday evening, March 13th. Gail, you're going to try and get that phone to Sheila,
yep.
And then we can move forward. Other than that...
I have a question, and I came in late, so maybe I missed it.
Yes.
Is this records request? Is this something that... Did I miss something? I don't know.
There was a public request for information that was requested from Sheila, our secretary... to go back 2015, 2016 inspections that were done. So
did you make it, the board made that?
No, I made that for the town clerk's office.
Yes. And Gail would like to take a look at those. I don't know. That's why I felt I needed to bring up how everything is tying into each other. It may just be general information. It may be that there is another issue. So maybe it's not put to bed yet.
So you request, what is it that you requested? I'm sorry?
The inspection reports, a copy of the inspection
the
reports.
The actual reports that have been done by?
That have been inspected, all the food inspection reports for the past 2 years.
For 2015?
And 16.
And 16. And how many is that?
100.
There's 420 sheets up there.
Oh.
On top of the file cabinet?
Okay. So you're getting the reports and all. Okay. Now I know.
Yeah.
I didn't know. Sorry. No, it's okay. I just didn't know.
I didn't know you weren't aware of that.
I was not.
It's more
that's
like
okay.
400. Well, I think it was 400.
It's not a board health issue. You requested it, right? I mean, on your own.
Yeah.
Okay. So
yeah.
I guess I didn't have to know. Okay.
Well.
Right now.
Never mind.
For now. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll just
so we have no other information to discuss. We have our meeting scheduled. Can we please get a motion to adjourn?
I'd like to make a motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.